next panel is going to be on careers. We have representatives from all the State Department and one from USAID. So hopefully you use this as an opportunity to sort of get a sense about, if you have questions about how to join the Department of State through the Foreign Service Exam, et cetera, you'll have a generally good idea of different ways that you can enter this field. So with that, I will turn it over to our panel moderator, Mignon, who is Press Officer for the Special Envoy to Sudan and South Sudan here at the State Department. Very lucky to have all of them here today with us. So thank you very much.
Great. Thank you. Now, let me see. I attended a historically black college. I went to Winston-Salem State University in North Carolina. So before we get started, I just want to do a conference roll call. Do we have any members of the CIAA in here? All right, that's my conference. CIAA, which school?
Johnson C. Smith.
All right. Congratulations, Johnson C. Smith. Let's give Johnson C. Smith a round of applause. I'm not bitter. That's okay. I'll applaud you this time. What about members of the MEAC? Do we have members of the MEAC in here? Which schools are here from the MEAC? Morgan State University? Morgan as well? Any other members from the MEAC? No. What school do you go to?
Howard.
Howard is the, MEAC. You are? Howard MEAC, okay. What about, let's see, we have SEAC. Do we have Morehouse College here? One member from Morehouse? Okay, thank you for representing Morehouse. What about anybody from the Eastern Collegiate Athletic Conference, Lincoln College? No? Anyone from the Southern Intercollegiate Athletic Conference? Oh, we said Morehouse. Southwestern, do we have no one from, okay, we have someone from Southwestern here as well. East Coast Conference, University of District of Columbia. Anyone here from, all right, University of District of Columbia, welcome. And Atlantic Coast Conference, University of Virginia. University of Virginia, no one here from University of Virginia? Okay, well, great. No. Well, thank you and welcome to all of you for coming here. As I said, my name is Mignon. I joined the State Department in 2006 and served in Mexico, Cameroon, and in Asia and the Philippines, and I've enjoyed every minute of it. My parents were proud supporters of historically black colleges. They went to Johnson C. Smith and Virginia State, and family from North Carolina Central and North Carolina A&T University. So we really support historically black colleges, and it's an honor for me to be on the panel with you all today. And right now, I'm pleased to introduce our panelists. As you know, Secretary Rice once said that she could attend an entire day of meetings and not see one person that looked like her in the meetings. And so today, I am pleased to introduce people who are changing that dynamic, faces that look like us, representing foreign affairs and foreign policy. And as we just heard here, we have members of civil service, foreign service, and USAID. So at this time, I'll just go over some of the ground rules. I'll introduce each of our panelists, and then we'll allow them to speak for 3 minutes, and then I'll open up the floor for questions, okay? All right, let's get started here. We'll start with the ladies first.
I'm so sorry. Linda Etem was not able to join us today, unfortunately. So my name is Tahalia Barrett. I'm a Foreign Service Officer with U.S. Agency for International Development. I've been there for about 5 years. I'm currently on rotation with the U.S. Global Development Lab, which is a new and kind of innovative arm of U.S. Agency for International Development. I'm happy to tell you a little bit more about what we do when there's a chance. But I've been with the agency for 5 years, as I mentioned. I've done tours in Kenya and Nepal prior to coming back to Washington, D.C., and I'm really just eager to speak with you all about how USAID is slightly different from what State Department Foreign Service officers do, and why you should consider and contemplate a job with USAID. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Etem. I'm just joking. Okay. Ms. Barrett. Barrett, is that pronounced right?
Barrett.
Ms. Barrett.
Yes.
Okay, welcome,
thanks,
Ms. Barrett. Okay, next we have Ms. Marembi Nantongo. Yes, Ms. Marembi is with us. Ms. Marembi joined the Foreign Service in 1995. She is a career member of the Foreign Service, which is very impressive. She's completed assignments in political military, and public diplomacy, as well as consular affairs. She served in Baghdad, Bangladesh, Colombia, Oman, Washington, Senegal, and Qatar. She is currently the Director of Mid-Level Division of Human Resources, Office of Career Development and Assignments. She also served as an Associate Dean in the School of Professional Affairs and Area Studies in the Foreign Service Institute, and she previously served as a Deputy Chief of Mission at the U.S. Embassy in Doha. So let's welcome also with us Ms. Marembi. Ms. Marembi, welcome. Now we'll move on with our gentlemen towards the end. First, we have Mr. Shanti Moore. Mr. Shanti joined the Foreign Service in 2000. Shanti currently serves as a deputy counselor for economic section in the U.S. mission to the Organization of American States. He's an economic cone officer who served in 5 consecutive overseas tours, including Kuwait, Qatar, Kosovo, Nicaragua, and Afghanistan. He specializes in trade, export promotion, private sector development, and commercial advocacy. He's fluent in Spanish and proficient in Arabic and Dari. Shanti received his undergraduate degree from Kansas State University, his graduate degree from Georgetown University, with a master's in science and foreign service program. He's also a Truman Scholar, a Fulbright Scholar, and a Pickering Fellow, which I'm sure he'll tell you more about. And Shanti was born in Michigan, so we're pleased to have Shanti Moore with us. And last but not least, we have Mr. Ricardo Gibson. Ricardo joined the State Department in 2010. He currently serves as a public affairs officer in the Bureau of International Narcotics and Law Enforcement. Ricardo engages with the press and civil society to promote U.S. foreign policy goals. He has developed media strategies for several U.S. government counter-narcotics initiatives, and he's received a Meritorious Honor Award for those efforts. So congratulations to Mr. Ricardo. Yeah. Mr. Ricardo is originally from St. Louis. He holds a bachelor's degree in English from DePaul University and a master's of arts in government studies from the Johns Hopkins University. He also earned a certificate in international studies from the Johns Hopkins University School for Advanced International Studies. He's worked as a congressional aide, a freelance journalist with the White House, as a congressional correspondent for a talk radio news service. So we're very lucky to have a fine panel with us today. And with that, I will turn the microphone over to our first speaker, Mrs. Barrett. Do you want to start? Who would you like to start with? Mrs. Would you like to go first?
Sure.
Okay.
What do you want? You just a little bit about me.
Yeah, I think how you joined and sort of your career path, I think would be interesting.
It's great to be here. Thank you all for being here despite the weather. I'll tell you just a little bit about my backstory and how I ended up here in the State Department. My father is Ugandan, my mother is Dutch, and I was born in Tanzania. And I went to school in England. And then after that, I returned to Uganda, and I got a job at the American Embassy in Kampala as what we call a foreign service national. And these are a hugely important demographic in the State Department. I think we have something like 47,000 foreign service nationals who support us in all our embassies worldwide. I started out as one of those. I spent a year as a foreign service national. And then I met my husband, who was working in the US Embassy at the time where I was working. We got married, and that made me another important demographic in the State Department, which is an eligible family member. And they are obviously the people who support our officers and our specialists as they go out on their assignments. So I went to Panama City with my ex-husband as an eligible family member, and I worked in the embassy in Panama City for a year. And while I was there, I interacted with Foreign Service officers extensively, and I thought, I can do this. And so I took the Foreign Service exam and passed it, and I became a member of another State Department demographic, Foreign Service officers. So I feel that I have had experience of the State Department from many different aspects, and I've enjoyed every single moment of my career. I started out in my first assignment was in WHA in Colombia and Bogota, and from there I went to NEA, the Near Eastern Affairs Bureau, and that was when I caught the Arabic bug. I think Linda Thomas-Greenfield was talking about bugs and infections. You'll find that there are various sort of populations in the State Department, and people get infected in different ways. You have sort of the Africa people, you have the Eastern European people, and then you have the sort of the NEA, the Arabic leaning kind of people. I took the 2-year Arabic language course, really, really enjoyed that. I think that was my most rewarding professional assignment. It was an assignment, 2 years to learn a language. And then since then, I've just been back and forth across the region. And now I'm back in Washington, and I'll turn it over to my colleague, but just to say that the State Department, of all the many benefits it has given me, the flexibility to live my life, my personal life, along with my professional life, has just been amazing. I think about it every day. I don't know where else we would get this kind of flexibility where I'm overseas, working hard, long hours all the time. And then when my family situation became such that I needed to sort of step back a little bit, have a little bit more predictable work-life balance, be able to deal with the things on the home front in a predictable way, I was able to find assignments in Washington, first at the Foreign Service Institute and then in the HR department, which really allowed me to make sure that certain areas of my life that needed attention got them. And now that everything is stabilized, and I'm looking forward to, in a year's time, going back out to, don't know, Yemen, Afghanistan, we'll see. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I know we're the last, so we'll try to keep it interesting. So I'm from Benton Harbor, Michigan. So any of you all who know Michigan, know that's a very small town. And so I was born and raised in Benton Harbor, and I grew up in Kansas, small towns in Kansas. I'm not from Kansas City. So, you know, my entry into the Foreign Service was really by accident. The first time I learned about the Foreign Service was taking a course at Kansas State University called the Professional Diplomat in Foreign Policy. So when I took the course taught by a former Foreign Service officer, I was smitten. I was like, wow, this is great, because I had never heard about the Foreign Service. So after that, I took that course. I said, I need to figure out how I'm going to join the Foreign Service. So yeah, you know, fortunately, I was blessed to win like a Truman Scholarship. I was a Fulbright scholar. So basically, I had my track, you know, or a plan of how to get into the Foreign Service. But one day, I was at K-State, and I saw on a bulletin what was then called the Graduate Foreign Affairs Fellowship, now known as the Pickering Fellowship. And basically what the Pickering Fellowship is about is it looks for top-notch students, you know, from underrepresented groups. And, you know, the deal is that, you know, it helps you, you know, get an education at a top-notch university, but then you have to provide or serve, you know, a minimum of 5 years to the Foreign Service. So I said, wow, this is great. So I applied for the Pickering. I received the fellowship. I went to Georgetown, and that was my, you know, entry to the Foreign Service. You know, part of the requirements of the Pickering is that you have to pass the Foreign Service exam. You have to pass the written exam and the oral exam. So, you know, I did that, I took the exam while I was studying at Georgetown, and then I finished it up when I served at my first assignment, which was Kuwait, and then the rest is history. So, you know, it was by accident that I joined the Foreign Service, but I've had a great career, and I just want to let you all know that you can do it. Listen, you know, if someone, you know, born and raised in Benton Harbor and grew up in small town Kansas can join the Foreign Service, then you all can do it. I mean, you all are going to very prestigious, you know, institutions, and I know that they prepare you quite well to, you know, to work, whether in the United States or in the world. So just remember that you can do it. Yes, you know, there's a certain way you have to, you know, learn how to take the Foreign Service exam. I mean, because it's a skill to take the Foreign Service exam. I mean, all of you are intelligent, or you wouldn't be here. But you know, it's a skill, and you have to learn how to take it. But you all can do it. So never doubt yourself. So please consider joining the Foreign Service. You know, we need more people of color, of underrepresented groups. I believe that the statistics for at least, you know, African Americans in the Foreign Service, at least when we in the Foreign Service, the generalists as we call them, is I guess between 5% and 7%. But when you get to what we call the Senior Foreign Service, it's less than that. I think it's 3% to 5%. So we need people of color. We need, you know, all groups, because you can make a difference, and you can be, you know, present at the creation of, you know, of, you know, international affairs, and you can make a difference even though you don't think you would, but you will. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ricardo Gibson. I work as the Public Affairs Officer in the Bureau for International Narcotics and Law Enforcement Affairs. So within my particular job, that requires me to work a lot with the media. So whether it's writing press releases, speaking to a reporter, if you ever pay attention to the news reports where you hear a senior government official says something, that's usually one of us in the back giving the standard USG line to the journalist to help inform their story. My journey to the department was a little bit different. I started out, I thought I wanted to be a journalist, so I came to Washington, wanted to change the world that way. Luckily, I was able to get an internship that allowed me to be the White House correspondent and congressional correspondent for the Talk Radio News Service. At the time, it was cutting edge because it was all online. This is 2003, I don't want to date myself, but it was a little bit ago. And I've caught the bug. Someone mentioned earlier about catching a bug. I caught the bug for DC. I was an English major in college. I thought I wanted to be a writer. I was all prepared to be the next Hemingway or something like that, but that didn't work out for me. So I came here and fell in love with the city. I knew that my area of focus wouldn't be journalism, but I wanted to do something service-oriented. So I ended up working on Capitol Hill, doing political campaigns, working in the private sector. All of that gave me good, knowledgeable experience, but at the same time, I knew that really wasn't my career path. And I found out one day about a career fair here in Washington, where it was gonna be an international fair. So the Department of State was scheduled to come. It was the CIA, USAID, a lot of these international based agencies that handle international affairs were coming. So I went there, met a career counselor, and that pretty much changed my life. At the time, I struck out several times. I tried to apply to the department 3 years in a row, didn't get it. So this time I was determined I'm going to get into the State Department. I don't know how. So I met this career counselor, got his business card, followed up with him, met with him over coffee, and he really helped me and helped coach me into preparing my application for the next time I apply to the department. And I applied through the Cooperative Education Program, which was the precursor to the Pathways Program. If you all are familiar with that, the Pathways Program is the way now that you get into the department through an internship. Luckily, that final time I tried, I got in. And that was it. That's all I needed. I said, I'm in, I'm staying, you're not kicking me out. This is what I'm gonna do. And I was fortunate to have a one-year fellowship with the Bureau of Public Affairs, which helped kind of transition me into the position that I am in now. And I've been in my current position for 4 years. And my experience has been great. It's been really rewarding. I had the opportunity to help staff the president on his trip to Hawaii to talk about the Asia Pacific Economic Cooperation Summit, which is pretty cool. I got an opportunity to work with a lot of other high-level officials here within the department, including deputy secretaries and all of those big name people here within the department. So I would really want to emphasize to you all that I was in your position not too long ago. I was a grad student looking to get into the department, and I was able to get in through this internship program. So if you really want to do it, definitely look at the opportunities that are out there. There are very, very many opportunities for you to come into the department, not just through the Foreign Service, but that's another way. But if you want to do civil service, that's an option as well. I'm a civil servant myself. So there's many opportunities. I can get more into that. I think I'm over my 3 minute limit, but I'll stop right there.
Hello again, everyone. My name is, again, Tahalia Barrett. I am a Foreign Service officer with USAID. And my experience really has come from a more technical angle. With USAID, they typically require that you have a master's degree before joining. You get the benefit of not having to take the Foreign Service exam, but you do have the additional burden of being more of a technical specialist. And so I came to USAID after a career that had me bouncing around a little bit. I basically enhanced SME development with entrepreneurs in Northern Africa. I had, and Sub-Saharan Africa, I had served in Nigeria as a member of an organization called MBAs Without Borders. I knew that I wanted to give back. I'd been, you know, engaged in business for social responsibility, net impact, and I'd evaluated like public and private partnerships between the Cancer Society and the private sector in Silicon Valley. And I really didn't exactly know what I wanted to do. So this was the MBA Without Borders opportunity was something that I took as a way to use my technical skills overseas. I ended up landing a position with a USAID contractor. And after working overseas in Nigeria for about a year, decided, yeah, I can do this. I can be overseas. You know, I miss my family, but I can hack it effectively overseas. And from there, I said, you know what, but I want to come into the agency. I want to be the person who helps to make the decisions about the types of development that we're doing overseas. And as luck would have it, at that time, USAID was hiring foreign service officers through, it was called the Development Leadership Initiative Program. We no longer have that right now, but what we do have, which I think is going to be very advantageous for all of you here, is a program that is called the Payne Fellows Program, and that program helps you to, it's kind of, I guess, like the Pickering program that State Department has, but it basically pays for your master's degree study so that you get a master's degree that's paid for by USAID. Then they provide you with an internship for about 3 months, I believe, where you then go overseas and stay with a USAID mission and do a rotation there. And then you actually come in and join the agency and start as a foreign service officer. So I really do encourage anyone who has a desire to give back, to be more involved in the development part of what we do as the US government, to join or consider the Payne Fellows Program and to contemplate joining USAID.
So this time we'll open it up to questions to each of our panelists. I may have to ask that you just sort of walk over to the microphone. And as we have some folks coming down, I just have one question for Ms. Marimbe. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Deputy Chief of Mission position, but this is essentially the number two in an embassy right under the ambassador. So it's very impressive that she was served as a Deputy Chief of Mission, and maybe we can have her speak about some of her challenges and her experiences as the Deputy Chief of Mission in Qatar.
It was a lot of fun, but it was hard work. You're the number two in the embassy, so you're sort of the ambassador's alter ego, and you're kind of responsible for the management of the embassy and stepping in when he or she is away to cover the policy side of the house. It's different from being a manager here in Washington, because when you take a community overseas, you become responsible for them in a different way. Things that are none of your business as a manager here become very much your business when you're overseas. Things that are normally sort of private and outside your purview as a manager in Washington become almost the center of your life sometimes, depending on the situation. So that was very interesting for me. And also positioning the embassy in order to move the bilateral relationship forward, I found as a fascinating endless challenge. You know, how do I get the most out of this person, out of this division, encourage people to work together? What are the partnerships that we have going that we need to establish? And then all the time making sure you're inside the ambassador's head and implementing the ambassador's vision. It was a fascinating opportunity, and I hope to do it again sometime soon.
Thanks, Miranda. And we applaud you for your efforts in Qatar. Thank you.
Thank you.
At this time, let's start with our questions. Maybe I'll start on this side with the young lady here in all black.
Okay, thank you. Once again, my name is Damola Aluko. I am a junior political science major at Howard University. And my question is for the woman who, I'm sorry, I forgot your name, but you work with USAID. I've applied to USAID a couple times, and I just wanted to know, what do you guys look for with interns? I did, the second time I applied for Near Eastern Affairs, and I'm still actually waiting. I don't know if you guys sent rejections and acceptances for your summer program yet, but I'm still like kind of waiting for that letter. And basically I just want to know what you guys are looking for in terms of that internship. Okay, thank you.
Thanks for your interest and your continued interest, hopefully. I'm not representing our career and outreach office. However, I do have contacts that I can definitely put you in touch with. I want to say that USAID has a number of ways that you can get involved. We used to have, for example, if you wanted to work overseas, there are opportunities to work in missions, and we have internships directly in missions. The other thing to know about USAID is, you know, we typically hire through these big batch programs, but that's not to say that you can't kind of create something different or new, depending on, you know, the skill sets that you bring to the table. So I want to encourage you to continue to apply to these programs. I don't know in your particular case. I'm happy to follow up with you afterwards, but also to think creatively, right, about what skill sets you have, what background you have, and who do you know, which networks do you know within the agency that might have an opening or an opportunity that could be expanded or crafted to accommodate you? And I think that goes, well, I can't say for the State Department, but I do know for USAID, you know, it's about the things that we advertise, but it's also about making sure that you network with the right people, or just with people in general, so that you can know about opportunities as they arise and then be able to apply.
Thank you. In the red.
Hello, my name is Devin Coney. I'm a graduating senior political science major from Howard. And my question is for Ms. Barrett. So with the Payne Fellowship, I did hear about that, like, I think like last semester, but I'm a graduating senior, so is it too late to like apply, or do you guys have to go, do like seniors have to go in right after they graduate?
That's another great question. I'm not the right person, but again, I have the right contacts. Tessa Henry is the woman that I'm working with to help spread the word, I guess, about the Payne Fellows program, and I'm going to be happy to connect you to her, and she'll be able to give you the information as to whether you can be eligible or not. My understanding, though, was that it was graduating seniors or recent graduates, but I don't want to speak out of turn, so I'm just going to connect you afterwards. If you'll come up afterwards, we can have that conversation. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Udodulam Namdi, and I'm a junior poli-sci student, African Studies minor from Howard University. And I kind of have two questions, if that's okay. One is specifically in regards to law and the Foreign Service. I know many others, have an interest in the cross-section between law and foreign affairs, specifically international criminal law, war crimes, et cetera. And a lot of the recruitment mechanisms, such as the Payne, the Pickering, which I am an applicant for, and the Wrangell, specifically exclude students looking to pursue law degrees or joint JDMAs. And I was wondering why that was, especially since a large degree of foreign people in the State Department come from legal backgrounds. And then secondly, my question is regards to languages. I would describe myself as partially proficient in maybe three languages, and one of them being an indigenous African language. And how would you guys suggest that we become more proficient in and advance in language and evolve our language skill set to become better suited for State Department positions? And are indigenous African languages considered an asset? Sorry.
Okay. Shanti, do you want to take the Pickering Law question?
As a Foreign Service officer, we deal in the realm of law, international law. So, you know, just thinking off the top of my head, I mean, if you wanted to join or serve in the, you know, in the Foreign Service, you'd work as a political science, as someone, you know, studying political science. I mean, think about our work in democracy, human rights, trafficking in persons. That correlates directly with law. I'm an economic officer, so, you know, I specialize in trade. So trade is 100% law, not only, you know, U.S. law, but also trying to negotiate, you know, the laws, you know, with our counterparts from other countries. So, I mean, that's one opportunity that, you know, you can usually go background to work in. And a lot of times, like, my colleagues who are lawyers specialize in those areas because they have the background, they have the expertise, and they're comfortable working with the law. So there are opportunities to usually go background, even though, again, you know, the Pickering Fellowship per se, you know, isn't exclusively tailored for people looking for, you know, or who want to pursue a law degree. With regards to how to improve your language, in my opinion, I think the best way you can improve your language, besides, you know, studying, taking courses, is just going to that country that you're interested in and just immersing yourself and just, you know, being frustrated and not understanding anything, because you'll pick it up. Because that's what happened to me. The way I learned Spanish was I participated in a community service program in Paraguay when I was an undergrad at Kansas State University. So yes, you know, I took courses in junior high school, in undergrad. But when I got to Paraguay, I didn't understand anything. And I was like, wow, why did I study all this long and I still can't understand anything? But, eventually, everything clicked. And actually, what really perfected my Spanish was when I won the Fulbright and I went back to Paraguay to study. I had to do everything in Spanish. I had to read, write. Think. I had to do everything in Spanish. I even had to write my thesis and do my presentation in Spanish. So just go abroad, immerse yourself. I think that's the best way to do it.
And if I could just add, the State Department, if you join as a Foreign Service officer, as a generalist, that's what you are, you're a generalist. So you're pretty much expected to be able to turn your talents to pretty much anything. You're a generalist. So while a particular background gives you a particular texture, a particular richness, I would stay away from the, I am studying this, and therefore this is what I want to do when I join the State Department, if you're looking at being a generalist. For example, my background is in French literature, French and Italian literature and language, which has been sort of tangentially useful to me, but it was certainly not any kind of I want to do this when I go to the State Department. Generalist, it means you got to turn on the dime, you can turn your, when they do the Foreign Service exam, they're sort of, what kind of brain have you got? And they're not necessarily asking what technical knowledge do you have in it. It's like, what is its agility? And they expect you to be able to turn your talents to pretty much anything that's thrown at you.
And they'll train you. Do you want to speak?
And they'll train you, yeah. Training. I mean, language, to go back to your question on language, the State Department, I think, is the only Foreign Service in the world that doesn't expect. I mean, I know there are incentives for people who have languages, but if you don't have a language, that's not a barrier. They expect people not to have languages, and they expect to have to train, and they really do do a good job of it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Did you want to add that?
Yeah, I just wanted to also say that for certain difficult languages or languages that are really hard to find in the marketplace, there are incentives, as was mentioned, and additional payment for being able to speak those languages. And so, yeah, before you come in. And I just wanted to encourage you to go ahead and pursue that and highlight that my Kiswahili teacher is here in the audience.
Sorry.
Question over here.
Hello. Hi. Thank you for coming to speak with us today. My name is Alexandra Maloney. I'm a Maryland resident, but I obtained my degree abroad at a university called John Cabot University, located in Rome, Italy. And my question technically would apply to all panelists, but I would like to specifically direct it to Director Nentogo. Because of your experience since 1995 with the various levels that you've worked in, being the only person of color, as you all mentioned earlier, whether it's in one meeting or for the entire day. And I remember doing a little research that there was a discrimination lawsuit in the 1970s or 80s, and I believe it was through the U.S. Information Agency, which no longer exists, but that lawsuit legally ensured the diversity and the diversification of the State Department, from my understanding. And I just wanted to know if any of the panelists could describe how the work climate has changed, if it has, on a daily basis as far as engaging with your counterparts of non-African origins.
I'm probably not the best person to talk about this. The State Department has been very good to me. As an institution, I mean, I've always felt it institutionally kind of looking out for diversity and sort of taking care of people who are not like everybody else. I guess in that regard, I mean, the most challenges that I came across are not necessarily from my U.S. counterparts. It's, in different countries, different places where you've been assigned, where perhaps attitudes are, different from than they are in the United States, and sort of understanding that, for example, in Baghdad, in Iraq, I was the embassy spokesperson, and I was doing media in Arabic. And there's just, flat-out racism in Iraq. And there were a lot of, in the focus groups that sort of asked about, the spokesperson, what do you think, there was always a lot of, well, why is that person speaking for the American government? And so it was, for me, quite actually invigorating that I mean, understanding that this was out there, but understanding that I was conveying a message by being the spokesperson for the U.S. government in this environment, and hoping that I was conveying something lasting to the people out there in Iraq. But internally, within the State Department, I think we're doing a fantastic job in terms of pulling in diversity in terms of women. We had a focus group yesterday when we were talking about the number of women working in the State Department compared to the number of women working in Google and Amazon, and I think it was Facebook or something. There was a study. And actually, the State Department has way more than any of those. You know, think about that. So I don't know if somebody else wants to talk about the difficulties.
Ricardo, do you want to speak on it from the civil service
perspective? From the, I'll give you the perspective from the civil service side. I've been here just for the Obama administration, but I can say that Under Secretary Clinton, she was very committed to diversity. Secretary Kerry has also continued that. There's a page on the careers.state.gov website that talks about the commitment to diversity. So those are, from my experience, I see it every day. Whether it's either the fellowships, there's also affinity groups here that will help you out. There's the African American affinity group called the Thursday Luncheon Group, which I'm a part of. Didn't mean to plug it, but I'll plug it now anyway. Which helps not just civil servant and foreign service officers, but students like you as well. You can be members, you can talk, you can get advice, mentors, things like that. So that's what I found, is that if I've run into a situation, I may be able to talk to someone who's been around a little bit longer than me, who can serve as a mentor to say, hey, well, you can navigate the State Department this way. Have you tried this particular avenue to go? So there's opportunities to get past that, but I would say that under this administration, they've been really committed to diversity, not just racially, but gender and economic as well.
Thank you. If you don't mind, we'll just continue moving along. Yes, sir.
I'm Brandon Greer, graduate student over at Morgan State University in the African American Studies program. My question is directed for the panel, but I really want to hear what my brothers have to say on the restrictions, requirements, and the image that the State Department is looking for when it comes to diversity.
I think what we're trying to do as an institution is look like America, which is very diverse. I'm not sure. Do you have anything to add?
Mm-hmm. Well, from my experience, I haven't seen where there's a particular prototype of an employee, but we've done a good job at reaching out to HBCUs, predominantly Latino colleges around the country as well. So we take our diplomat in residence. We have several throughout the country, and they go to colleges and universities to promote the department, to speak about diversity. So there isn't a kind of cardboard cutout of what we think someone is. I mean, I'm from the Midwest, I'm from St. Louis. You know, there was no way I ever thought I'd be here within the State Department. I always saw the department as something it's an East Coast elitist, you know, someone like myself from the middle of the country, I didn't belong here. But I don't fit that mold, but I was able to get in. I think that we shouldn't look at it as you have to fit this particular frame to become into the department. We are accepting everyone. And I think that if you're really interested, there's many avenues to go to, and you don't have to fit, you know, some buttoned up person. You know, you can be yourself, you know.
And if I could just add on to that, when it comes to diversity with your educational background, as you can see from our panelists, English backgrounds, political science backgrounds, language, linguistics, and so the Foreign Service is really interested in having a variety of people, you know, so that we can represent the United States, as Ms. Marimbi stated. You can come in from any discipline and join the Foreign Service, because we've moved away from that sort of white, male, political science Foreign Service, as you can see. And so that's what we want to continue to do and keep on sort of representing the United States' diversity abroad. So does that answer your question?
Yeah. Can I just add one point, too? One thing, as you were talking, it kind of brought up an experience that I had. I was one of two African Americans in a meeting with some senior level officials when I was preparing for the president's APEC summit in Hawaii. I think that experience for me was good on several levels, because I was able to come in, I had to brief the governor at the time, the governor of Hawaii, the mayor of Honolulu, I mean, and a lot of these big officials who were, we were working with them to coordinate everything down from the hotel reservations to when the delegation would come in. A lot of these, you know, things that you put together from behind the scenes of the conference. And I had to brief the governor, and I knew that coming into it, you know, people may get an image of me because I'm an African-American man. I wanted to make sure that I put my best foot forward. So I don't think, there will be opportunities and sometimes obstacles, but putting your best foot forward always works. And within that experience, I, you know, talked to the governor afterward, and he, you know, commended me for doing a good job at briefing him about these particular issues. So I think that you can come in and being yourself and being professional and presenting not just the face of the department, but for you as well, because you're representing yourself as well as the State Department.
Hello, my name is Adria Andreas. I'm a sophomore political science major, community development minor from Howard University. You guys seem to go hand in hand with the State Department and USAID, so I wanted to know, for someone who's looking to work abroad, but mainly on education and take a holistic approach, what would be the best option and why? And is there opportunities to, you know, work at the State Department as well as switch over to USAID? Like, are there opportunities to do that as well?
I do happen to know, actually, that we have what we call crossover assignments. You have to be, obviously, on board as a USAID officer or as a state officer, but then once you are, they have an annual program where we switch a whole bunch of positions, so I, as an FSO, could go and work for USAID and vice versa. When you say education, you mean teaching or...?
I would say teaching as well as changing the structure. Like, my main goal is to work in Haiti and work on that education structure.
Right.
To fix it.
Okay, well, then go ahead. You can tell her about it.
I was going to say, come to aid. but on a serious note, I think, you know, there are benefits for working in the State Department. As mentioned, you know, you are a generalist when you come to the State Department. If you have a technical specialty and if you want to work on development issues, I would really advocate that you join USAID. You know, we also work in those really hard countries like Haiti. You know, we're in Haiti, we're in Angola, we're in, you know, the difficult places where development really needs to happen. And so if you have the passion, the energy, the interest in working on any of those issues, then, and with people who similarly have that passion, then come on over to USAID. I think the detail opportunities definitely exist, and that's another benefit. So if you start with aid and, you know, maybe it's not exactly the right fit, there is an opportunity for you to go elsewhere and see what else is out there, not just at the State Department, but the other Foreign Service organizations that we have. So that could be Commerce, Foreign Agriculture Service, depending on your background. So please don't feel limited. Come on board. If you have a master's degree, passion and interest, join AID, and you want to specialize, try to join AID.
Mm-hmm. If I may just add, on the Foreign Service side, if you're interested in educational programming, the public affairs cone is probably one of the best cones to do that. I'm a public affairs officer, and when you're abroad, you help students apply for Fulbright scholarships to study for their master's or their PhD in the United States. You help run English language programs to teach English overseas, other sorts of professional educational exchanges. You will help students apply for them, get accepted, get the funding to go to the United States on those scholarships. So that's a different aspect from the policy, but if you're interested in foreign service, there are ways to work on educational programming.
Hi, I'm also a political science major, community development minor from Howard University, and my name is Tondalea DeRosa, and I want to thank you so much for this panel because I'm still trying to figure out what career path I want to take because I'm more interested in leaving a trail than following a particular path. But I'm also interested in more of the personal narratives, and my question surrounds, and when there's times where you feel like there's obstacles where sometimes, I don't know, if you feel like, well, maybe this isn't the job for me, or there's something that happened where you feel like it just takes all your energy and you feel like it's like, how do you get out or how do you find a solution to figure out a certain solution to a certain problem? What methods or is there like a certain, I want to say like, hope or passion? Like, what kind of mantra or anything do you use to get past any obstacles that you face in your job? This is open end for anybody.
Anybody want to start?
Go ahead. Okay. For me, you know, there's always going to be those ups and downs within any job that you have. So from my experience, I just have to remind myself that I worked 3 years to get here. A lot of people don't get that. A lot of people try and try and try, and they don't get into the State Department. So I'm one of the lucky ones. And this is where I really want it to be. And if there's something that gets me down too much, I'll call one of my colleagues who also serves as a mentor and just talk with them. Sometimes we'll meet over coffee and like, man, I can't believe this. They got me doing 15 projects. And then, you know, we're able to talk through and able to kind of help me strategize a little bit more kind of how to really make sure I hit all those priorities, make sure I prioritize whatever tasks that I need to have. So, you know, developing a good network is key for me, understanding kind of where we are and the privilege we have to represent the United States government and to come here every day and to know the work that you do will have an impact globally. Is key for me. So I have to kind of keep reminding myself that during the downtime and during those times where it may get a little tough that, you know, I worked here, I worked to get here, I'm working to stay here. So a little trouble isn't bad. You know, you just kind of got to get over that hump and having people to help you out is key.
And also, if you're a member of the Foreign Service, you always have the luxury of knowing that, okay, just a couple more years and I'll have a different job. So that does help kind of get you through when it is really tough. You know that it won't be forever.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to say, is that the Foreign Service is a beautiful place to be because it always affords the opportunity to keep learning and to do different things. And it might not be as a Foreign Service officer. You know, her illustrious career indicates you can do a whole host of things when you join the Foreign Service. And so I really would encourage people to, again, contemplate if you love learning, if this is, you know, you want to do something different kind of every 2 to 3 to 4 years, this is kind of the career for you, I think.
Finally, I'll add that. A lot of the challenges that at least I can talk about in the Foreign Service, State Department that we face, you know, personality, you know, it could be personality conflicts, management style. And the key is you have to talk, you know, to your supervisor. So quick tip, communication skills, oral and written communication skills are key in the State Department, Foreign Service, and whatever we do. So it's also key that you talk to your supervisors and, you know, talk to their supervisors if you're having challenges, if they're, you know, personality-driven conflicts or managerial conflicts. But if it's beyond that, then you have to find it within yourself to say that, hey, you know, I'm going to do this, put my best foot forward. Because, yeah, I'll admit there has been, like, at least one or two jobs that when I thought they'd be good, then when I, you know, started them, I was like, and when I got into them, I was like, wow, it's not the job I wanted. But, my goal is always to put my best foot forward, do my best, because, you know, people are looking at you, people are watching you, and you may never know who you work with may help you get, you know, the job that you really want.
Mm-hmm. And I think just to add on a personal level, several of you have traveled abroad, so you've experienced, when you're a long way from home, sometimes when I was in the Philippines, it's a, you know, large difference between time zones. And so calling your parents, they're asleep when you're waking up, and they're waking up when you're asleep. And so you lose touch, and you're not home for all the holidays. And that can be tough. But I think the rewards sort of outweigh sometimes some of those hardships, because it's so rewarding, I think, for our careers to find students abroad studying in Cameroon and give them, you know, that opportunity to get their master's in the United States. It completely changes their lives. It changes their professional, you know, trajectory. And so I think seeing sort of the accomplishments and what you can do abroad as U.S. government officials is really rewarding, and that sort of outweighs some of those hardships that you experience when you're abroad.
Hello, my name is Jelena Jevtić, and I'm an international student from Serbia, mm-hmm. and currently a freshman at Bluefield State College with a major in political science. First of all, I would like to thank you for dedicating your time to answering our questions. And I would like to ask a question. I would like to ask Mr. Moore a question regarding his personal experience in Kosovo. Given that I'm of Serbian nationality, but a representative of United States institution, how difficult it would be for me to go work in Kosovo with an aim to promote peace and work on enhancing the relationship between Serbians and Kosovars. Thank you.
Obviously, you know the history of, you know, Kosovo quite well, so you know the history of relations between, you know, Kosovo Serbia, Kosovo Serbs, Kosovo Albanians. So I don't have to tell you that. I mean, it will be challenging initially because, you know, there's been, you know, years of, you know, mistrust. You know, there was a war over Kosovo, so it wouldn't be easy. But you would make a difference, and you know it would be a challenge for you to work with, you know, the Kosovo Albanians because, again, I mean, years of mistrust and just, you know, the tension and the friction surrounding Kosovo and, you know, Kosovo status, Kosovo independence. But you can make an impact, and you will, and then once you break through, you will make a difference, and you will impress, you know, the Kosovo Albanians, and you'll definitely impress Kosovo Serbs who, you know, are still in Kosovo and those who want to stay and, you know, make their lives in Kosovo. So you'll make a big difference. It won't be easy, and it will be challenging, it will be frustrating, and you will have, you know, people who are not tolerant. But it will make a big difference because that's been one of our goals, to try to, you know, get Serb, I'll say, just say, you know, Serbs in general, but probably particularly Kosovar Serbs, you know, to be part of the Kosovo government, be part of, you know, Kosovo civil society, just become more part of the country, because we believe that will help, you know, the country and the relations between, you know, both groups.
There are some situations where, like, for example, my father is Ugandan. Me going back to serve in a place in Uganda would be something that the diplomatic security people would take a look at and decide whether or not it was appropriate for me to do that. So kind of on a case-by-case basis, it's not always a no, but it could be sometimes depending on the linkages that you have in your country of origin.
Hi, my name is Legima Do. I'm a Cameroonian. I obtained my Bachelor of Science degree in Accounting from the University of Boya and Master's of Science International Accounting from the University of Gothenburg in Sweden, and Advanced Diploma in Danish Language and Danish Culture. And currently, I'm a PhD student in Business Leadership and Administration in Hampton University. I want to thank Mrs. Mignon abundantly for the work they've been doing in Cameroon. I think most of my brothers and sisters back home hold education with very high esteem. But unfortunately, most of them lack the privileges to advance educational careers. So my question is, what can we do to help those of our people back home to maximize the benefits provided by your association? And secondly, to the UNAID officer, what languages do you designate as incentivized languages?
Okay. Good questions. I would say if you're here, the best way to support Cameroonians who are interested in studying in the United States would be to make sure your family members and your friends are tuned in on to the U.S. Embassy website, because we are making announcements on our scholarships, our fellowships, our, you know, different international visitor leadership programs. They all go up on our U.S. Embassy website, so as long as they follow that and the Twitter page and Facebook page and those sorts of things, that's probably the first point of contact. But they can also reach out to our U.S. Embassy Cultural Affairs section, our information officers at POST, and inquire about some of the upcoming educational exchanges as well. So just getting them in contact, and we can speak after the session about who to talk to at the U.S. Embassy in Cameroon.
And then for the languages, are there more than the super hard languages that are incentivized? We have what we call this very technical category of super hard languages. And that's Arabic, Korean, Chinese, and Japanese. Mm-hmm. And I think those are all incentivized. Farsi. I can't remember. Is Farsi one of those?
Yeah.
It's on the website, isn't it?
Yes.
careers.gov. Mm-hmm. And it's a list. And if you have languages when you come in, it gives you a certain kind of a leg up, mm-hmm. I think.
I just wanted to add, I've been really impressed with the number of people who are, I guess, diasporans in the room, And I just wanted to say that with USAID, we are definitely interested in working with diasporans, trying to figure out how to corral, harness, you know, the talent, the networks, the financial contributions that you guys are making to your home countries. And so, you know, look out for opportunities on the USAID website as well for that are reaching out for diasporans who want to do business back in their home countries, who want to really help, you know, people in developing countries to have opportunities and to network, right, to take advantage of U.S. government-supported opportunities.
Final question.
Hi, my name is Isabella Hazel. I'm also a political science major, community development minor at Howard University. And I'm currently debating whether I want to go back home to St. Vincent or stay here to work. A lot of students from the Caribbean come to the United States and they don't really look back and leave their countries in the dust. And a lot of the Caribbean nations really need us, you know, the ones who are getting an education and to go back and reform. So I guess my question is, not only is it hard to work back home with a government that's corrupt and led by money, so my main question is, what is the likelihood that we can work for USAID or here in the State Department in foreign policy and be allocated in a region of our interest?
Well, in the State Department, it's worldwide availability. So, you know, the getting to a place where you particularly want to be could happen once or twice in your career. I mean, we're expected to have a broad exposure. We're expected to travel widely and expected to sort of have general a general approach to our work. So, again, if you want to specialize in a particular country or particular region, I think you would have difficulty over the long term in the State Department. I don't know if USAID, if it's different.
It's mostly the same. So we have the same tenets of worldwide availability. I've just done tours in, as I mentioned, Africa Bureau. So I was in Kenya. I was in Nepal. I'm trying to get back to Latin America and the Caribbean because I'm actually of Jamaican descent and would love to be actually an officer in Jamaica. Wouldn't that be wonderful? But it's not guaranteed. And so, you know, a career is about 20 years. You think each tour, depending on whether you're USAID or not, is 2 to 4 years. So you figure you can do maybe five to six tours over the course of your career, and you may get back there, but it's not guaranteed. I encourage you to join us and take your skills elsewhere, but also, you know, recognize the conversation that you're having in your head about, you know, which way to go is real.
Let me just add, my colleagues are right, but at least the way I see the State Department working is, you know, as you move up in the Foreign Service, you have to specialize. So you will have to choose, you know, one or two regions in which you need to specialize. Because to be honest, like I said, you know, if you want to get the jobs of serving certain regions, you know, what we call our bureaus, whether it's the Bureau of, you know, Western Affairs, European Affairs, you know, Near Eastern Affairs, they want to know who you are, and you know they feel more comfortable with people who they work with, who they know will do a good job. So I you know, in my opinion, I believe that, you know, you can, you know, specialize in one or two areas, and you know, if you know the senior people who get to know you, they'll take care of you. And I know, like I said, we're journalists and we can and will serve anywhere, but in my opinion, the reality is that, you know, as you move up, you have to specialize, because if you have Arabic, it's highly likely that the Bureau of Near Eastern Affairs will want to keep you. If you are a very good Spanish speaker, you know, 4-4 or higher, you know, Western Hemisphere Affairs will want to keep you. If you specialize in Chinese, you know, I'm sure, you know, our Near East Bureau will want to keep you. So keep that in mind as well.
So if we don't have any further questions, maybe I'll just ask our panelists to provide us some words of wisdom for our young, talented group, maybe thinking about USAID or Foreign Service. Sort of, what advice would you have as these students prepare to apply for the Pickering or the Payne scholarships or to apply for the Foreign Service exam? Do we want to start? Do you want to start?
Sure. Okay. I would say just be relentless. You know, don't get discouraged. Definitely think of this as an opportunity. to learn. I've mentioned this before, but you're going to be going all around the world, and I think that's the beauty of actually being within the Foreign Service, is that you get to take some of the things that you learned in one experience in a totally different country and see how that they apply and can be utilized for the betterment and the development of a different group of people in a different continent, possibly. But I think, you know, for your career, it's about being relentless and making sure that you, as others have mentioned at this table, put your best foot forward at all times, independent of the discouragement that you may face, and keep your eye on the prize, right? Remember why you're doing this. For me, it's about development. It's my passion to see a better outcome and a better society for people who are not as privileged as I have been. And so maintaining that throughout my is what helps me move things forward in my career. And I'm hoping that there's a few of you in the audience who will contemplate and join USAID Foreign Service.
And I would just echo exactly what she said. I mean, it's a wonderful profession, a wonderful opportunity. But also self-knowledge is important. Understand what it is that you want to do, what you will enjoy doing. It's not for everyone. There are difficult choices to make. There are family issues you have to consider. Be thoughtful about it. And if you decide that this is what you want to do, be relentless. Take that exam, take it again, and just keep going.
I'll add, if you want to serve and you want to do something, you know, different, unique, every 2 or 3 years, consider the Foreign Service or USAID. If you want to make a difference, consider the State Department, Foreign Service, or USAID. I would always try to tell people, especially, you know, from Kansas who don't know anything about the Foreign Service, like, why is what you do, Foreign Service, diplomacy, important? I always say, well, you know, listen, diplomacy is the first line of defense for the United States. So, you know, before, you know, we want our military to go fight wars and get involved in conflicts, you know, it's our job to try to, you know, maintain peace, build good relations with other countries, and just make sure that the global system is working for everyone. So keep that in mind. And finally, remember, you know, we're looking for leaders who, you know, who have great communication skills. In the State Department, in USAID, you have to have great oral and written communication skills. So when you're taking that Foreign Service exam, you know, practice your writing skills, because that's what trips up most people. I'm sure you all who are interested in international affairs read the paper, you know a lot about international affairs, but you want to make sure you practice, you know, those essays, because that's what gets most people on the written exam and the oral exam, even though I'm more old school, so I think the exam has changed.
I agree with all the other panelists. I just would want to also plug the civil service. We've been talking a lot about the Foreign Service. I am a civil service officer, so I'm based here in Washington, but I've been able to travel. I've been able to do rotation assignments. So there's opportunities here if you want to stay within Washington, but travel overseas for a year or 6 months. There's opportunities to do that and come back. Some people may not, you know, the Foreign Service may not be for them, but the civil service allows you that ability to do a rotation for 3 months or to do, or for a year or something. I found my experience here very rewarding. I get to meet, you know, young aspiring FSOs like yourself. So it's always a good opportunity to talk with you all, because I know the position that you're in. I was in there not too long ago. So I would just say, keep trying, keep plugging away, and you're gonna make it. You know, if this is what you really, really want to do, you're gonna find that in. I found mine after 3 years of trying, but you know, yours may be a year, yours may be two, but just keep plugging away, you'll get it.
With that, we'll conclude our panel today. I'd like to thank our panelists. Yes, please give them a round of applause. Thank you. And also on behalf of the panel, thank you for coming out, for being interested in foreign affairs. Please go home and thank your parents for allowing you to come out to Washington during this bad weather and giving you the opportunity to study abroad and take interest in foreign affairs, because they may not see you as much as they'd like to, but we'd like to see you around. So we hope to see you out in post or here, like Ricardo said, in Washington. And you have another comment?
No.
Okay. So with that, thank you very much, and we'll be here to talk if you need to talk one-on-one.